Kind of. There we go. Okay. Well, welcome everybody. Today we're talking with Rebecca Kelley, and she's the author of No One Knows Us Here. Hi, Rebecca.
Hi, thanks for having me.
You're welcome. Well, tell us how you got the inspiration for this story in the first place.
How I first came up with this idea a long time ago, maybe 9 years ago, I wrote this list for Bustle called These Novels Would Have Been Better with Female Protagonists. It was a kind of a tongue-in-cheek list, and one of them was Crime and Punishment. And I just started thinking of, well, what would Crime and Punishment be like if the main character were a woman? And I started thinking of that character. I was really intrigued by a character who justifies to himself that murdering someone could be the right thing to do or the ethical thing to do because the world would be a better place without that person. And a lot of problems would be resolved without that person living.
Right.
So that's how it all started.
Okay. And so tell us a little bit about the storyline for No One Knows Us Here.
Well, it's about a 23-year-old named Rosemary who is just trying to make ends meet, working at a kitchen store and living in her ex-boyfriend's closet when her recently orphaned half-sister Wendy shows up asking to be taken in. And then Rosemary is reluctant at first, but then she ends up going to some extreme lengths to try to make things work with Wendy, including agreeing to be the paid girlfriend of this kind of quirky tech billionaire.
Yeah, Leo Glass, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah. He's quite a character. tell us a little bit about her experience with Leo.
Well, she can't figure Leo out because he seems kind of normal. Like he's about 30, so he's not much older. And he's really rich, but he seems to be really cheap in some ways. And he doesn't live the kind of life maybe she would expect him to live. And then she finally agrees to be his girlfriend, but then she can't figure out what he wants exactly. Doesn't seem to be what she expected it to be.
And I think maybe what he really wants is what, the girlfriend experience? Is that what?
Yeah.
So he sets her up in an apartment and does all sorts of nice things for her?
Yeah, he seems to create a life for her that is very hard for her to say no to, or it seems like too good to be true in some ways, like everything he's offering. But then it seems like he wants her to pretend to be his real girlfriend, and he doesn't want to talk about the arrangement. So she keeps trying to figure out, well, what does that mean?
And then things turn rotten.
Yeah.
Without giving away too much, can you tell us a little bit about what he does to her?
Well, he just seems to be kind of controlling, but then it seems like everything he does, he seems to have some sort of explanation that maybe could make sense. So then she starts wondering, well, am I just overthinking this, or I did agree to this? So maybe I just need to play along with it to keep up this ruse so that, you know, I can support my sister and live in this nice apartment. And, but she starts getting, also, she just starts questioning herself a lot and almost kind of unraveling the weirder he gets. Then, like, she kind of almost goes a little, well, she gets very off-kilter.
Gets off-kilter herself. Okay, well, maybe I shouldn't tell what happens. That would be a spoiler, huh?
I'm not sure, because on the first pages, you kind of, it opens with what I guess could be a spoiler.
Right. It's already, we already know that she's going to off him. Well, you know, you almost, in some way, after reading what he does to her, you almost want to cheer for her. And then another character, Sam, comes into the picture along the way. And what, tell us her experience with Sam.
Yeah, so Sam is her next door neighbor, and he's a bit, the scenario is opposite with Sam, because Leo says, well, you can just decide to love someone. We can both just decide we should love each other, and then it'll happen, and we can be the perfect couple. And that's just logical. Whereas Sam, her experience with him is more of a love at first sight, like, oh, that's not really very convenient for to fall in love right now, but I find myself falling for you kind of situation. So it's sort of the opposite of what's happening with Leo. Like, well, what happens when you meet someone who seems like you really have a connection with, but it's not really the right time? You're supposed to be a tech billionaire's girlfriend right now. Can you resist that kind of thing, or should you? And what happens when you don't?
Okay. Well, many interesting events along the way, I'll say. And this is your second book, right? Your second novel.
Yeah, that's right.
What differences did you find in writing the second novel to the first novel? Was it easier? Was it harder?
In some ways, it was harder. I wrote the book Broken Homes and Gardens. For whatever reason, I was just really inspired to write it. I felt like, oh, I really want to write this story. And it just seemed to all come pouring out of me. It was like, oh, I've got to write this. And I feel like I wrote it really fast. And like, I believed in it. And I was like, I'm going to just write this thing. Whereas with No One Knows Us Here, I had the idea for so long. And then I kept thinking about it. I mean, probably for years before I even wrote the first chapter. And I didn't feel inspired. You know, I didn't feel like, oh, I can just sit down and write it the same way. But then I decided, or I looked into it, because I was like, where did my inspiration go? You know, if I had it once, maybe I can get it back. And I was sort of learning about inspiration. And I looked into what other authors said about it. And what most of them said kind of surprised me. And that was that you shouldn't wait for inspiration. And some even don't even believe in inspiration. They're just saying, you know, it's not inspiration that helps you write. It's sitting down and doing it every day, even if you don't feel inspired. And I really didn't like the sound of that, because I like the idea of writing when you're really inspired and you just want to write and it all comes pouring out. But I decided to give it a try. And I resolved to sit there every day for 30 days. I decided I would write for an hour a day for 30 days. And I decided on an hour because I thought, well, that's probably enough time to get something done, but not so much time if I'm really uninspired, just staring at the screen, that I would, you know, give up. And I did it. And then after 30 days, I had written 24,000 words.
Whoa.
And I was like, wow, I got something done doing this sitting in a chair method that everyone says is how you write a book. And so I kept it going. And then I added another 30 days. I did it like in a streak, you know, where you kind of mark things off on the calendar, like keeping a perfect streak when you do something. And I did it for 411 days. Whoa. And that's how I wrote the book.
Whoa, that's awesome. That's awesome. But then How did you find an agent or a publisher? Was that difficult?
Well, I had the same agent that I already had for Broken Homes and Gardens. And I'd actually sent her a couple different projects over the years, but they never really got off the ground. And then I gave her No One Knows Us Here. I'm not even sure when it was. I just remember she started shopping it around about January of 2020. But if you remember what happened,
Oh my goodness.
All of a sudden the pandemic started, and then I guess publishing kind of slowed down at that point, or at least that's what I was thinking. And I just didn't hear anything about it. Like, I was like, I guess nothing happened with it. And I didn't even really ask her for updates, because I was thinking, I don't want to be depressed, like hearing about all the rejections I've gotten. But it wasn't until June of 2021 that my agent, she saw a tweet from Melissa Valentine at Lake Union, who said she was looking, and I don't even know what the tweet said, but something reminded Jen, my agent, of my book. And so she pitched it to Melissa, and then Melissa, I guess, loved it.
Wonderful.
And then we started talking, and it all snowballed from there.
Wow. Who's your agent, and who is the editor at Lake Union? What are their names?
Jen Chen Tran was my agent. And she works for Folio Literary Agency now.
Oh, okay.
And well, it's kind of a long story, but I won't get into that.
That's okay.
Then, Melissa Valentine was my editor at Lake Union.
Yeah. Well, Folio is a really good agency. You're with the best. Now, I know also that you have taught writing for many years, and that you also have an MBA in writing, I believe. Tell us a little bit about your background.
Well, I have a master's in writing that I got many years ago in the early 2000s. And then I was teaching at a small art college called Oregon College of Art and Craft for many years. But then, unfortunately, it went out of business.
Oh.
Mm. Yeah, so that was in 2019. And so I... don't work there anymore.
Okay.
I did enjoy working there for many years.
what have you learned? Let me ask you this. What about rejection? How do you deal with rejection?
Well, it can be really hard to deal with it. Although I think the more that you do it, you kind of get used to it and almost maybe expect it as a writer. I feel like early on, like, you know, when I was really young, I wrote a book and I sent it to 4 agents. This was in the 90s. And I got immediately rejected by all of them. And I just never sent that book out again. You know, you're like, well, they don't want it. I guess my book is terrible. Giving up. But you really have to, you can't just stop at the first 4 rejections you get. I think you kind of have to expect it's going to be a part of the process. And it helps to think of all those, you always hear about all these successful writers who, like, you know, were rejected 500 times before their best-selling book got picked up. So that's always kind of encouraging, I guess.
Did you rewrite the book a number of times, or, you know, how much editing did you have to do after you got your first draft on the page?
Oh, a lot, because my first draft was really long. I mean, I bet it was over 500 pages long. It was kind of really rambling, or, you know, like there were just a lot of extra scenes and, like, even extra characters, and So it was just because, you know, I did that process I was talking about of just writing every day for 411 days. And so I ended up with this huge draft. And it took me a long time just looking at the draft and kind of chipping away at it and editing it to get it to a tighter manuscript.
And did Jen help you with that, your agent? Did she help you with that? Or was it mainly on your own, the editing process?
You know, it was probably, I did that. And then I probably sent it to Jen. And then she gave me, you know, her thoughts. And then I probably did more editing. It like keeps just going, you know, on and on.
Sure.
And then there's a whole editing process that happens like even after your book gets picked up, because I had a developmental editor and then copy editors. So it's like this very involved editing process, which is okay with me because I actually like editing. I almost prefer it to writing because, you know, as I was describing, it was this painstaking process. Whereas editing, you have everything down on the page, like you have everything to work with.
Yes, yes.
And so it's like a bit more liberating, I guess, or I can just like, oh, get rid of this 20-page passage that's doing no good in this book. No problem.
And how have you found working with like Union Publishing? What was that? What has that experience been like for you?
I've been really surprised because, you know, it's a part of Amazon Publishing, which is a huge corporation, but Lake Union feels like a really small boutique kind of agency where you get a lot of attention.
Cool.
Like, I feel like I know, you know, the different people who work there. Like, I don't feel like I'm a cog in a big machine. Uh-huh. Like, I feel like they give me a lot of attention, which is really nice, obviously. And then at the same time, they have all the resources to market your book, which, you know, Broken Homes and Gardens was published by a small press. And even though they really liked my book and believed in my book and wanted to publish it, it's not like they have the resources that Lake Union has to like get it out there.
Sure. Yeah.
And so it feels like a lot more, like you get a lot more visibility and it's kind of more exciting, you know, when you can see things moving.
Oh, that's good. So they're doing a lot of promotion then for you, or reasonable promotion for the book. Yeah.
Yeah. I've been surprised. There's been also just the publishing has changed a lot, even the last few years since Broken Homes and Gardens came out, because that was 2015. But there's so much just social media that happens with book publishing, you know, like Bookstagram and book talkers and booktubers. So much can happen just online. The way it was more like get your feet on the ground, you know, like even for my very first book that I co-wrote with my friend Joy Hatch, which was it was called The Economical Baby Guide, a guidebook for raising babies in a eco-friendly manner. But a lot of the stuff we did for that book was like going to actual stores and asking, like, will you carry the book? Everything was kind of, what do you call it? It wasn't really online that we were focusing
personal.
On.
Personal, it was in person.
Right. Right. So there's just so much you can do from your own living room these days. Like right now, like I'm having this interview sitting at home, you know?
Right. All the way from Portland. I believe you live in Portland.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And what do you do when you're not writing? I think you have a husband and a couple of kids, maybe?
I have a husband and one child who is almost 17.
Oh.
And what I like to do, or, you know, after I stopped working at Oregon College of Art and Craft because it went out of business, I decided to study graphic design. And so I'm trying to get maybe a career, a second career.
Yes.
And then and I like to bake. So that's all like right. One of my main hobbies, baking.
What's your favorite dish? What's your favorite pastry or whatever?
I like, probably the thing I've made the most over the years are cinnamon rolls.
Wow.
And I also like to bake tarts and pies.
All right. Well, you stay busy all the time then.
Yeah.
Well, one more question, and that is, what would you say to encourage writers who are trying to break into being published?
Well, I'd probably say what a professor said to me once many years ago, because I asked him basically the same question, like, of everyone you know who's been successful, what is it that they did to get where they are today? And he said that the main thing is to just, everyone he knows who's successful is successful because they kept at it. They didn't give up.
Right.
And it seems very simple, but it makes sense. Like, well, because I was thinking, like, should I just quit writing? Like, what if there's no point?
Yeah.
And it's like, well, if I quit, I definitely will not succeed as a writer. Whereas if I keep going, I could.
There you go. And you did. You could and you did.
Yeah.
So congratulations, Rebecca Kelley. She's the author of No One Knows Us Here. And we thank you very much for being with us today.
Well, thank you for having me.
Okay. All right. I think we've got it. Let's see. Wait a minute. I want to stop recording.